นะโมทัสสะภะคะวะโตอะระหะโตสัมมาสัมพุทธัสสะนะโมทัสสะภะคะวะโตอะระหะโตสัมมาสัมพุทธัสสะนะโมทัสสะภะคะวะโตอะระหะโตสัมมาสัมพุทธัสสะพุทธังธัมมังสังฆังนะมัสสามิSo today we've been participating in this event, Ajahn Chah Remembrance Day. It's 20 years since he passed away. Something that's very praiseworthy.Both those who've come together to organize the event had to give up their time and energy and resources to do that. And for all of those of you who've participated today, giving up your time for the Dhamma, for practicing Dhamma, listening to Dhamma, making offerings, keeping precepts, meditating,And we say making an offering out of your practice. This is an appropriate way to display our gratitude to our teacher by actually offering our efforts in the practice. So I think that's what Ajahn Chah was encouraging through his life, having practiced very sincerely for himself. Sometimes he would say,He had to go through great difficulty to bring people the Dhamma that he taught. In fact, sometimes he even had to put his life on the line or his life at stake. As in those early years when he was practicing in the last century, the life of a forest monk living in the jungle, very difficult.The support was minimal, medicines, food and so on, quite difficult to come by. So it was a very difficult life physically, and he had to experience quite a bit of hardship, but he did that willingly for the Dhamma. He sacrificed for the Dhamma, and he always reminded his students, Sangha and laity, that really the Dhamma does have to grow through the sacrifice we make, but it's sacrifice for a good purpose, even though it sounds, just the very word sounds a bit worrying, a sacrifice. As we make so many sacrifices in life, one more sacrifice sounds like trouble, but it's a worthy sacrifice. And that's the flavor of the Dhamma, giving up to the Dhamma. It's the way he taughtto give up to the Dhamma, to be sincere in our practice, and then you'll get more out of it. Whether it's meditation, dana, precepts. He seemed to embody the teachings, which gave many people great hope and happiness that the Buddha's teachings are still alive today and have beencarried on. You know, the Buddha was alive 2,500 years ago, so sometimes that sounds like a long time ago, and it's very easy to get lost in the feeling maybe it's not relevant anymore. You know, a nice philosophy to believe in, some good ideas, but maybe not relevant. But it's our good fortune that teachers like Ajahn Chah have existed in the world to show us that the teachings are still relevant.And human beings still can practice the way of the Dhamma in this current era. And even if we didn't meet Lumpo Cha personally, we can still benefit from his teachings through the books and through the living Sangha of his students that is still here, reminding us that this teaching is relevant and it really is the way that leads out of suffering. And I don't think anybody in this world likes suffering. But what Ajahn Chah pointed out was that if you want to really experience the end of suffering and the happiness of that, then we have to practice. We have to give up to the practice, we have to learn how to practice and then put it into practice in our daily lives. There's a famous saying the Buddha gave, Jittang Dantang Sukhavahang, a well-trained mind brings happiness. And my understanding of Ajahn Chah is that he's a teacher who encouraged people to train for themselves. And he always pointed out that a teacher can lead by example, and he was a very good example. They can encourage, they can give skillful means for us as students to practice, but they can't do it for us. We have to do the practice for ourselves through our own efforts. And that's our great good fortune that teachers like Ajahn Chah have been in existence to give us that encouragement and give us skillful means and reflections and give us the roadmap for how to practice for the end of suffering. And we're lucky, very, very lucky, very fortunate that with these examples, teachers such as Ajahn Chah and his Sangha, the roadmap to the end of suffering is here for us to follow. We have the Sangha to lead us when we have doubts or confusion in the practice. We can turn to the Sangha as those who are experienced in the practice to point out where we are on the roadmap, maybe where we're lost or getting stuck or straying from the path. The important point is there is a roadmap, there is a way to follow, a way to practice, and that's our good fortune. It's something that perhaps we could say we're celebrating today, the fact that we do have a living tradition, a living teaching that can help us in our daily lives to sort out some of the confusion, some of the stress that we inevitably meet living in this world as human beings. So Ajahn Chah was always pointing to the Dhamma and encouraging us to look to the Dhamma, to understand Dhamma, meaning understand truth. The truth of this body, this mind, the truth about life as we lead it, and particularly to understand where does suffering come from? Where does stress come from? How can we deal with it? And the Buddha's teachings are very clear here. They cover everything. The Buddha's teachings give us a very clear way to understand the mind and how to free it from suffering. The Buddha didn't make it very complicated for us. He said you only really need to know and understand four things. And most of us can count to four. So four things. Suffering, get to know what suffering is, understand suffering and its stress and its nature. Get to understand its cause. And having understood, known what the cause of suffering is, well, abandon that, give it up. Experience the end of suffering, the cessation of suffering for oneself in one's own mind. And then to know what the path that leads to the end of suffering is and to follow it. So to know suffering, its cause, the end of suffering and the path that leads to the end of the suffering. Only four things. Now, this is what we're practicing as Buddhists. This is what we're learning about and looking at in our daily lives. And Ajahn Chah, very, very skillful. If you read his books, he's constantly giving us different methods and strategies and reflections on how to do this, where to look, and to look at your own mind. You know, suffering, the suffering that you can remedy, it arises in your own mind, in your own thinking, in your own experience. Obviously there's a lot of suffering in this world that there's not much we can do about. So it's not like Buddhism gives you some teaching that sort of is a miraculous cure for everything and will solve every bit of suffering in this world. But the suffering we can cure is in our own minds, isn't it? Our own wrong thinking that comes up, takes over the mind, leads to craving and attachment, greed, anger, delusion, and leads to the experience of stress in daily life. This is what we can do something about. And just as we were practicing meditation a few minutes ago, you know, when you learn to develop some inner awareness, the ability to look back at your own mind, you can see where suffering arises, can't you? And you can also see where it ends. And you see, suffering arises and ends in the same place. It may be simply just grasping onto some thought, some mood that's come up in your life through some experience, and just recognizing that by turning your awareness back on yourself, looking at your own mind more closely, you might see, oh, I'm doing this to myself. You know, maybe just some feeling of tension from your physical condition. We have health issues and the aging of this body. Maybe something external, what's going on in our life, in our family life, our work, the pressures of these things living in the world. But where we actually experience suffering and the end of suffering is in our own mind, isn't it? It's in our own consciousness. So that's where we've got to look, and that's where we've got to learn what to do to remove the causes of stress from the mind. How do we do that? Often we don't actually have to go anywhere or do very much. We simply take that time to stop and pay more attention to what's going on in our life, to what we're thinking, what we're saying, what we're doing from moment to moment through our day. So Ajahn Chah would always be encouraging to develop this quality of mindful awareness and a clear understanding, learning how to reflect wisely on what we're doing, to look more deeply at what we're doing and see what leads to what. You know, if we do feel we're experiencing some suffering, some unhappiness, or well, where does it come from? There must be a cause somewhere. These things don't just pop into our minds and our life at random. There's causes, aren't there? And often just the very lack of awareness in itself is the main cause. Or sometimes it's just some wrong view, some wrong thinking we've been caught into that's come up and we haven't seen. So learning to look back and investigate more deeply is very much at the heart of the practice. So how do we do that? Well, we have to learn how to facilitate that, how to develop the right skills to be able to see our own minds better and know and understand our own minds better. So the basic training that Ajahn Chah encouraged, just like any wise Buddhist teachers since the time of the Buddha, is a very practical and easy to understand pathway for developing the qualities to look after this mind and free it from suffering. So always beginning with, you know, just develop a sense of basic sense of generosity and awareness, sensitivity of other people living in this world as well as oneself, and understand the relationship between oneself and others in this world. As we're born into this world as human beings, we tend to have a basic delusion that we're always caught up with our own business, our own body and mind, our own aspirations and ambitions, our own thoughts and desires. But often we don't see how we're relating to the world around us. So the very heart of Buddhist practice always begins with generosity and appreciation that we're not here alone. We couldn't be, could we? Because we've got parents. Yeah. Nobody comes into this world on their own. We have parents who give us birth, look after us, teach us, bring us up, give us language. If we didn't have language, we wouldn't even be able to hear the Dhamma. So our parents have given us much, and our teachers and many other people have helped us. So the beginning of Dhamma practice is just recognizing that, isn't it? Just realizing, oh, I'm not here alone. There are other people that I depend on that have helped me. And then the next step is, well, what can I do, give back to them? What can I do to support the world, not only for their benefit, but also for my own benefit? You know, if you practice any form of dana, generosity, where you're actually thinking of others as well as yourself, the effect on the mind is it brings oneself a lot of joy, a lot of peace, a lot of happiness and good memories, and obviously we do benefit that which is beneficial for others around us. This is the very heart and the beginning of the Buddhist path, just recognizing that fact that we're not here alone in this world, and that other people matter as well as us, and our relations with other people matter as well. So Ajahn Chah, very good at encouraging that, encouraging us to not only see that, but to practice that, you know, to practice dana, to give something back to those that have given to us, to take care with the world around us, our environment, meaning other people in society, and the environment around us, to take care of it, and not to get too caught up in our own selfish desires all the time, but also to see the importance that when we look after other people and the world around us, we're also looking after ourselves. You are nourishing your own mind with very wholesome dhammas, very skillful states of mind, when you take an interest in others and the world around us. So they go hand in hand. The way Ajahn Chah would talk about this, we call it the Brahma Vihara Dhammas, the dwelling place of Brahma. Brahma means those divine beings in heavenly abodes with sense of unconditional kindness, compassion, sympathetic joy and equanimity. And these four qualities that the Buddha and teachers like Ajahn Chah encompass. And very good examples of that. These are qualities to develop in our daily life. You know, the basic attitudes of kindness, compassion, caring for oneself, caring for others, seeing the importance of both, not to be careless or not to neglect the fact that we've been born into this world with a human body and all that it brings with it, a human body, a human mind. You know, this is our great good fortune. And not to be heedless with that birth, but to actually make use of our human birth in the best possible way. We're developing ourselves and doing that which is beneficial for ourselves and for others. If one gets that basic attitude right, you know, this sort of basic understanding, the importance of establishing our heart in kindness, compassion, sympathetic joy, equanimity, these qualities of the Brahma Viharas, then the attitude is right for developing the other aspects of the path, developing the mindfulness and the wisdom that helps us to clear up our own minds, sort out our own minds and let go of those ways of thinking, those attitudes, those views which cause us so much suffering. One thing leads on to the other. If we nourish our own mind in the right way, well, the results come. Unfortunately, the way of the world tends to go in the other way, isn't it? It's always about grabbing things, grasping at things, thinking the more I get, the happier I'll be. Whether it's material gain or different experiences of pleasure in this world, that's the way of the world, the way of what we say darkness. You know, that leads on to more grasping, more attachment, more suffering. Suffering because we're never satisfied. If you're always following your craving, just trying to grasp at the things in this world, you'll never be satisfied, will you? Because you can never have enough, because we're living in this world, sharing it with now 7 billion people. You know, if land is the thing you want, well, you're never going to get enough land if you've got 7 billion people to share the world with. You're only going to get a little bit of it at most. Material wealth, all the money, the gold and the other thing, fine things of this world, well, you're never going to get it all, are you? Because you've got to share it with others. So the way of the world is the way of craving and grasping. And if we haven't seen that, then we tend to just always be dissatisfied, discontent, wanting more, wanting to get more, get better, get ahead of others, get more than others. Ajahn Chah always encourages to look back and say, well, the way of the world doesn't actually lead to peace and happiness, does it? It leads to more discontent, dissatisfaction with what we've got. Even if we've got a lot, it's never enough. We always want more. Whereas the way of Dhamma is going the opposite way. It's the way of enough. Learning to appreciate what we do have. Appreciate this body and mind that we do have. Appreciate the good experiences, the good people we know, the good things of this world that we do have and that we do come in contact with. That's the way of Dhamma. It's the way of having that sense of contentment. And it is enough. You know, it's a reflection, isn't it? Learning how to reflect on your mind to see what will bring it to peace. So just now we were practicing breathing meditation. Now this is practicing learning to what experience a mind that is content. You know, it's content enough to just be with one breath in, one breath out. As an idea, it sounds very, very minimal, not very attractive to the way of the world, the way of worldly thinking. You know, you go to a cocktail party and tell your friends, I'm just practicing contentment with one breath in, one breath out. Well, probably they won't be very impressed. They'll want you to be telling them about, you know, your successes in business and work and, you know, your kids and which school they're going to and all the kind of normal successes that we talk about. But that's the way of the world, the way of craving, and you'll never find peace in that, unfortunately. Whereas just to learn to be content with one breath in, breath out, that's the way to enlightenment. It's worth stopping and thinking about that. Why did Ajahn Chah and the Buddha teach this? Seems to be going in completely the opposite direction of worldly thinking, ordinary thinking. Ordinary thinking, you say, I've got to get more, 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 more. But just look at that state of mind that is wanting more, more, more. It's not peaceful, is it? It's not content. Even when you come to do breathing meditation, sometimes we still bring that same attitude in. And so you're sitting there, breathe in, breathe out, and it's, you know, when am I going to get peaceful? When am I going to get some happiness, get samadhi? When am I going to get the Dhamma? Still we bring the same mind of craving and attachment in, the same mind that drives us crazy in our daily life with discontent and dissatisfaction. So again, we have to look at that. Stop and look and see what's happening to our own mind and start to settle down and let go of these things a little bit. Ajahn Chah said, if you meditate and you're trying to find a peaceful mind or gain a peaceful mind in that way through craving, he said, it's like looking for a turtle with a moustache. You'll never find it. You can't gain peace, as it were. You can't grasp at peace or sort of get peace in the same way you might, you know, you say, oh, I want to make some money and go and buy something, or have, there's something you really want, you want to buy a house or a car. It's not like that. The way peace arises in the mind is actually through letting go of all the grasping, all the desiring, all the discontent, all the worry, all that mental stress. You actually have to let go of it. See the suffering of it and let go. And then the mind starts to experience peace all by itself through understanding and actually experiencing peace or being at peace. And this is a very important point, because as long as Buddhism for us remains a kind of superficial practice, that something we just believe in, we believe in karma, we believe in the Buddha was a good person, and we're trying to practice or be good Buddhists, just on the level of belief, is not enough to really experience a peaceful mind. We have to start to internalize it, take it in, and start to recognize the source of suffering for ourselves in our own mind, this mind of discontent. And discontent from trying to grasp at things, want things all the time, never satisfied with what we've got. Or the mind that's trying to push away things that we don't like, experiences that we don't like, people that we don't like, and so on. In short, it's these two experiences of attraction and aversion that unsettle the human mind, and it's only through observing and learning about this that we'll ever bring the mind to peace and the end of suffering. So over and over again, if you read Ajahn Chah's books, listen to his talks, this is what he's talking about, learning to let go of the mind that's always grasping at things, pushing things away that we don't like, grasping at things that we want. Learning to see that, see the suffering of that, and let go, and bring the mind to its place of natural place of peace in the middle. Place where it's content within itself. Place where it has a sense of enough. This is enough, good enough. That's something we have to experience through our own efforts. It's not something you can just believe in, or you can't buy that, you can't get it from another person. You have to actually find that through your own efforts. And this is why we encourage to develop the Buddhist path in practice in daily life, to develop the precepts, use them as a guideline, develop mindfulness, and learn to wisely reflect on our experience. And that's where you can really bring your mind to the sense of inner satisfaction that Lumbo Cha was talking about. Probably if you've meditated just a few times, you might start to understand what he's talking about. That's how I began my Dhamma practice. Having heard some Dhamma, I went away, joined a meditation group, and started to experience a little bit of the peaceful mind, the mind where it's letting go of all its confusion and grasping and just being more content within itself. And I could see, or every teaching Ajahn Chah gave, it comes out of this kind of inner awareness where you're just learning to be more in touch with your own body and mind as it is in the present moment. All the other Buddhist teachings come out of that, and you can understand from that. You can understand that ultimately this world that we live in, you know, it's very temporary, isn't it? Very impermanent. You can have as much happiness and pleasure that this world can give you, but it's all very temporary. You can travel, you can earn money, you can go here, go there, have the nicest food, the nicest place to live, and the nicest clothes, and everything that this world gives you, all of it very temporary. The real place where we can find true inner happiness is inwardly, through training this mind, developing it with mindfulness and wisdom. And we have to come to the conclusion, we have to accept the fact we are getting older every day. None of us are getting younger. As we get older, this body is starting to wear out. It gives us more aches and pains, more problems. The things of this world that we can experience, we'll also have to leave behind as we leave this world. We can't take it with us. What can we take with us? It's the mind, the peaceful mind and the good karma we've developed through our practice. That's our ultimate refuge. You know, that's the Buddha within us, or the Dhamma within us. You know, the Buddha is not so much out there, the statue or the Buddha who lived 2,500 years ago. What the Buddha really said is the real Buddha is the Dhamma that arises in our own heart, where we see the true nature of this world. We see this world is very temporary, very impermanent. It's ultimately something we cannot own, we cannot take with us. Even our own body we can't take with us, we have to let go. When we can see that and accept that through contemplating, understanding the Dhamma, just as Ajahn Chah taught us, then the mind starts to become peaceful. That sense of peace, that's the Buddha arising within, that's the mind that sees the Buddha, sees the Dhamma. One who sees the Dhamma sees the Buddha. Ajahn Chah sometimes would say to people who were feeling sad that they didn't get born in the time of the Buddha, or they'd never been to India, and were thinking somehow they're distant from the Buddha, he'd say, well, the Buddha can only be born in India, is that true? And really, the Buddha can be born anywhere, because everybody in this world has the potential for awakening, for understanding Dhamma. So the Buddha can really be born anywhere where somebody is practicing the Dhamma sincerely and bringing their own mind in line with the truth, and the Buddha can arise there. In any country, could be Malaysia, Thailand, Europe, America, anywhere. any time, any place where your mind comes in line with truth, in line with Dhamma, then it comes in line with the Buddha. And as you keep practicing and get more experienced and age a little bit, you'll realize that that's more important than anything else. You know, when you die, you take the Dhamma in your own heart with you. That's your refuge, that's your spiritual wealth that will travel with you into your next life. It's what you brought with you in this life that brought you to this point where you have faith in the Buddha and Dhamma Sangha and you come to practice like this. And it will take you on in the next life to meet with the Buddhist teachings again. Everything else is very, very temporary, impermanent, no real refuge at all. So the more we can practice and bring our minds in line with the Dhamma, the more benefit we'll gain from that, the more we'll benefit other people as well. So today, I don't have much time, so I'll probably give you just this much teaching for now. You've had teachings from many other monks, and there'll be more teachings to come. So I'll finish off just wishing you all success in your lives, in your Dhamma practice. Give you my anumodana, appreciation for the efforts that you've made in coming here today, to all those who organized the event, all of you for participating in this event. And I hope it may be a cause for your own enlightenment. As Ajahn Chah would say, Nibbanang Pachayo Hotu. May this be a cause for Nibbana, your own enlightenment, for you to experience the end of suffering. May that come to true fruition, true realization. So I'll just say this much for now and wish you all success and happiness.